who do they go to? Naturally, they go to customs first. So customs is engaged in interpretative analysis through administrative rulings. Through administrative rulings, so they would, as an importer, or even prospective importer, you do not have to already engage in import, you can go to customs and say, customs, would you please help me out? I do not know what classification is, I do not know what the duty rate is, and I'm not sure how to market, right? So, while providing the snippet there, I also provided the quick link. So again, in lawcustoms.com, there is a CBP cross link, and that cross is really the search engine. It's kind of like a customs Google. And if you, it is a compilation of customs reasoning, thinking, and application to various commodities of a harmonized tariff schedule of the United States. So, and they have anything. So let's say you have festive articles, for example. And you have this festive articles, this is a combination word. See, as you can see, it came back with 1,542 results. And it starts with headquarters. So you can see customs is doing this at the headquarters level, as well as more less substantial, if you will, but equally important, New York level. So in New York City, at the federal building, I believe 10th floor, there is a team of commodity specialists, they're called national commodity specialists, that work for customs, and all they do all day is look at the product. So they look at this laser pointer, and they say, okay, this laser pointer should be classified under such and such provision, for such and such reasons. Of course, sometimes their writing is not as good. Sometimes New York can make mistakes, and headquarters takes a second look and reinterprets. Another body, governing body that takes a, let me see, no. All right, so another body that takes a look at the classification, the harmonized tariff schedule, is the judicial branch. And it is done at the federal level. And of course, at the federal level, we have specialty courts. All they do, well, not all, they do a bunch of other things, but most of the things they do, most of their daily business relates to what is the appropriate duty? Is the item classified correctly? And of course, there is something about New York, because we have commodity national specialist in New York City. And then we have a court of exclusive jurisdiction, court of international trade. It used to be customs court. The name changed, I believe, in early 80s. And it was changed to adopt more appealing name, Court of International Trade. And usually the judges who sit there, they deal exclusively with customs matters. So, and whenever you ask judges to determine, they also publish their opinions. And their opinions is sometimes referred to as a ruling. The judge rules that for example, the applicable harmonized tariff schedule number for the marker will be under, for example, chapter 96. So the Court of International Trade, just like customs, they have their own website, and they have their website for the slip opinions, and it's called slip opinions. Slip refers to the particular case number, or like a docket. An opinion refers to the judge's reasoning and rationale as how and the reasons why this product is classified under the certain provision. All right, so now we get to the interesting part. Now we get to exceptions. So the general rule, if you recall, that all items coming to the United States, they must be classified according to the harmonized tariff schedule. Now, we have express exceptions. As it turns out, some items do not have to be classified. Welcome. So, what are these items that do not have to be classified? Well, we have a whole list. But what's interesting here, take a look at the my annotations, right? Where, how do I know this exception? Where do I get it from? And it's interesting to take a look. Of course, we have general note, which is a part of the harmonized tariff schedule. And in this case, it's general note 3E. But we also have developed, customs has developed what is called a legal precedent, or more appropriate word for this would be the administrative precedent. And what this precedent refers to is, yes, some items are not subject to the HTSUS, but in a way, they may be subject to the United States. So my goal was to say, all right, how do I teach an exception where such an exception may or may not exist? Where do I draw the line? And to really see where the line is drawn, I really go and see what these guys have to say, the customs. And usually here, it would be the customs headquarters. And I will not bore you with the opinion, but this situation can be the meaning and their reading, the customs reading of this provision can really be easily checked. So let's say headquarters ruling 114459. We just go to the headquarters ruling site, 114459. Just simply enter it in the Google like search engine, and right there, and you have, and you can enjoy reading the application of a particular customs opinion to the particular situation. So, going back, let's take a look which items are not subject to the harmonized tariff schedule of the United States. Now, why are we covering this? Well, because exceptions are also being tested by customs just like the general rules. So in this situation, it is extremely important to know what these exceptions are, because customs examiners has attested on these particular exceptions in the past. And because they've done it, there is no reassurance that they will not do this again, such as at the next examination. So let's take a look. Following items are not subject to the harmonized tariff schedule of the United States, meaning when they come into the country, you don't need to classify them. And sometimes this makes sense. So think about yourself coming into the country. What you do? You come in from overseas with the luggage, and you wait at the line. Nowadays, customs, at least in JFK Airport, they adopted those kiosks for the U.S. citizens. So you go to the kiosk and you get some kind of, you scan your passport, U.S. passport, and you get a printout. And you take this printout and it says, go to such and such desk or line. But at the end of the day, you come in and you look at the customs inspector and you hope everything goes right. And the customs inspector looks at this with a serious face and says, where have you been? Why are you coming to this country? So, usually this question goes to the non-US citizen. Even if the United States citizens, what were you doing outside of this country? What was your business? Etc. And you stand there and you're like, So one of the questions customs inspector does not ask is, okay, what's your classification? How can I, where are you in the, they say, everything must be, I know there is a rule, customs inspector may say, there is a rule that says everything must be classified, and I know this because there is a citation, which I just cited in the class. And, but they never do that. Why? Because people, we don't classify people, because people are special. We can classify animals, and I know, if you talk to certain scientists, to all scientists, I think, they will say humans are animals too, right? Homo sapiens. But customs really puts humans in a different category. So going off the human example, corpses, human remains, together with their coffins and accompanying flowers, should not be classified. Of course, this first line item spurred a huge discussion in the customs community because the United States is one of the major importers of body parts. So let's say you bring in a certain organ, right, into the United States. Let's say you bring a kidney. On a quick flight to the hospital, should you classify, how would you classify, is it a human remain, right? If it's human remain, can you just not classify it, even though it costs thousands and thousands of dollars, for example, the hospital is paying so much money. So a lot of discussions really shaped around this, and we shall see how they apply. In the context, but usually customs will not take you to that level where they say, all right, from South Africa, a charter airplane arrived carrying kidneys from organ donors for the US patients. Should the US patients or the hospital classify those kidneys? Usually it will not be at that level. It usually be something simple. A dead body comes in. Do you classify it or not classify it? Sometimes they even make it easier. Corpse comes in, and to get the point to the exam taker, they will say the corpse comes in together with the coffins and the accompanying flowers. So then you really know whether the answer is true or false because you really know that customs examiners are asking you about this particular situation. So, articles returned from space. Well, what other articles returned from space? Well, how about capsules, right? We send astronauts up and they return a capsule. Yeah? So, once they return, what happens to the capsule? Usually, they're taken and brought in. It wouldn't, should this be classified? Well, most likely not, because it's an article returned from space. More interesting are the number 3 and probably number 4, because articles which are exported subject to this criteria, they are not classified. It usually refers to where you send something to someone. Let's say you send something to your grandma, and your grandma was out of town. The mailman didn't deliver it. The mailman came back. The grandma was this time visiting the grandpa in the other part of the town. So the mailman that just doesn't have luck. So the mailman says, "Okay, you know what, grandma? You are not getting the present from your U.S. Grandson, who is living in the United States." So we're gonna pack it up and ship it back to the United States because you're just not available. In this situation, so long as it's done within 45 days, it's undeliverable, grandma can nowhere be found, and has not left the custody of the carrier, right? So the postman always has it with him, right? What situation can be where it left the custody? So if you send it by UPS, right? UPS comes in, they They even have the line on the declaration or on the paperwork form, like what to do with the abandoned item, right? If it's abandoned, you can just what to do with the item which is undeliverable. And I think they have like a line item checkbox where to regard it as abandoned, right? And if it's abandoned, you can dispose it. Meaning, whichever way, right? And it can be done in such a way, the disposal, where it can leave the custody. And if it somehow gets back to the United States, it is outside. It did leave custody, and this criteria fails. Notice, and. So all three must be met in order for the article not to be subject to the HTSUS, the 10-digit provision.